Welcome to CBS Friday. Tonight, an all-new 48 Hours Investigates, followed by new episodes of Hack and Robbery Homicide Division. It's all here on CBS right now.
If our DNA matched anything significant, they would have arrested us in a New York minute.
New information, new evidence, new leads in the murder of JonBenet Ramsey. Take a look at this.
I did not kill my child.
48 Hours Investigates has obtained the police interrogation tapes of John and Patsy Ramsey, never made public until tonight.
I don't give a flying flip how scientific it is. Go back to the damn drawing board.
Frankly, she and JonBenet were extremely close.
Aaron Moriarty heads up our six-month investigation.
I don't think the Ramseys did it, and I think they ought to start looking for people that did.
We have evidence the police ignored for 4 years.
Oh, you can't play this on camera.
And a chilling conversation with one man the Ramseys say deserves a closer look.
He related to me that he'd done something horrible.
Did you hurt or kill JonBenet Ramsey?
48 Hours Investigates, searching for a killer.
Good evening, and welcome to 48 Hours Investigates. I'm Leslie Stahl. Tonight, we've got something remarkable for you. If you're like most Americans, you probably think that John and Patsy Ramsey are hiding something in the murder of their daughter, JonBenet. In fact, in a new poll for 48 Hours Investigates, 52% say they believe one or both parents were involved in the murder in some way. Aaron Moriarty reports the results of our exclusive investigation that could change your mind.
She was the spark plug of our family. Because of this zest that she had, she just kept things alive and hopping. It's not the same without her.
Why is it so hard for people to understand that we love this child with everything in our being? We would never touch a hair on the head of one of our children. I mean, it just is inconceivable to me.
Their faces are instantly recognizable, but John and Patsy Ramsey are famous in a way no one would want. Although they've never been publicly called suspects or charged with the 1996 death of their daughter, JonBenet, they are resigned to a painful reality.
We could find the killer tomorrow. He could be arrested, convicted, and, you know, jailed, and there'd still be 20% of the population would think that we had something to do with it.
48 Hours Investigates is taking a fresh look at the Ramsey case. You will hear about new evidence and new leads. We will also tell you the Ramseys' personal story and what they think happened here in their Boulder, Colorado home on Christmas night nearly 6 years ago. And we will also show tonight something that has never been seen publicly.
She screamed my name.
Videotapes of the police interrogation of both John and Patsy Ramsey.
I didn't do it. John Ramsey didn't do it, and we didn't have a clue of anybody who did do it.
But first, the Ramseys today. In a rare interview, they agreed to a completely unrestricted discussion of the case.
Did your daughter have a bedwetting incident that night? Did you get up? Did you get angry? And did you hurt her?
No, I did not.
What is your reaction when you know many people think that's what you did?
They are wrong. I don't know what else to say. How else do you say no except no? No means no.
Over the last several months, we have spent a great deal of time with the Ramseys.
these favorite villains of the tabloids.
Big old tires make this thing hard to turn.
And have seen them in a way few others have.
Fishing box. That hadn't been used in a long time.
On this day, just this past summer,
old flight bag.
John and Patsy Ramsey are moving.
Life has never been the same, and it has basically ruined us financially and emotionally and everything else. So we're scaling back. This is my wedding dress.
They are selling their million-dollar home in Atlanta and moving to a smaller townhouse just down the road. John Ramsey, once the head of a billion-dollar software company, hasn't worked for 4 years, while Patsy has been quite literally fighting for her life.
This is my self-portrait. Here's my broken heart, my tears.
In a rare, unguarded moment.
I thought I would paint during my cancer treatment, but I was just so sick, I couldn't.
Without her makeup, without her wig, without even her eyebrows drawn in, you can clearly see the damage left by the return of her cancer.
How did you find out?
I was back in February for my annual checkup.
9 years ago, Patsy learned she had stage 4 ovarian cancer. She made what she hoped was a full recovery. But earlier this year, she again went through debilitating chemotherapy.
You lost your hair?
Yes. It's growing back. My eyebrows are growing back. It all comes out, but you know what? That's very little thing to worry about.
In fact, Patsy Ramsey has much bigger concerns. Almost from the moment the body of their 6-year-old daughter, JonBenet, was discovered, Boulder police believe John and Patsy killed their daughter and then staged a kidnapping, complete with a rambling 2.5-page ransom note to cover it up.
They've never investigated this case. Other than to investigate the family. Mm-hmm. They have never investigated this case.
Even though a Boulder grand jury in 1999, looking at all the evidence, decided not to indict the Ramseys, and while police say they haven't ruled out other theories, to this day, the Ramseys remain the prime suspects, as you will see in this videotape obtained exclusively by 48 Hours.
You have not classified any individual as a suspect.
Publicly correct.
While testifying under oath in a civil case just last November, Boulder Police Chief Mark Beckner admitted what he had never before said publicly.
Internally, John and Patsy are considered suspects.
Both of them?
Yes.
Are considered to have probably been involved in the death of their daughter?
Probability, yes.
Why do you think you remain probably the prime suspect in the eyes of the Boulder police?
I asked Mark Beckner that. I came closer to him in the face than I am to you, Aaron, and I said, tell me what it is that makes you think I killed my beautiful, precious child. And he said, well, it's just a lot of little things. I think he really doesn't know.
But because police didn't have enough evidence, sources within the investigation tell 48 Hours, the police tried to psychologically break the Ramseys, hoping one or both would confess.
It was a strategy that was put in place to bring immense pressure on us to break us.
That strategy, by some in the department, claims John Ramsey, included a relentless campaign of leaks fed mostly to the nation's tabloids that had a devastating effect on public opinion.
They convinced the public of guilt.
Lynn Wood is John and Patsy Ramsey's attorney.
You couldn't go to buy groceries for your family without passing headlines that said that John Ramsey had molested his first daughter. Absolutely false. Headlines that John and Patsy Ramsey were pornographers. Absolutely false. Headlines that they were devil worshippers, absolutely false.
The Ramseys believe that the Boulder police still, to this day, continue to ignore evidence pointing to other suspects.
It's frustrating, it's disappointing, it makes me angry.
You say it makes you angry, but you don't seem angry. Do you think that's also hurt you
in the eyes of the public?
Well, we're not soap opera actors. I mean, I suppose if I was an actor, I could act really angry, but I'm not. That's who I am. It's what you see. And I'm angry. This is angry for me.
Angry because John Ramsey says a killer or killers remain free.
What I do know is that we didn't kill our daughter. So let's look at the rest of the picture, guys.
Next on 48 Hours Investigates.
My life has been hell from that day forward.
The police interrogation of the Ramseys you've never seen before.
Today's date is
June 23rd, 1998.
Broomfield Police Department, right at the
time, was approximately 9:04.
A year and a half after JonBenet was murdered, John and Patsy Ramsey, sitting in separate rooms at the same time, were questioned by Boulder authorities in a Colorado police station. These tapes have never before been seen publicly.
There's been a lot of speculation by a lot of people that maybe you didn't know anything about the murder, but maybe Patsy did.
Questioning John is Lou Smith, a homicide detective then working for the Boulder DA's office.
It's preposterous. I mean, Patsy loves both her children dearly, but frankly, she and JonBenet were extremely close.
A Christmas morning photo of the kids.
Detective Tom Haney questioned Patsy, who at the time was taking medication for both anxiety and depression.
If I told you right now that we have trace evidence that appears to link you to the death of JonBenet, what would you tell me?
That's totally impossible. Go retest.
How is it impossible?
I did not kill my child. I didn't have a thing to do with it.
And I'm not talking, you know, somebody's guess or some rumor or some story.
I don't care what you're talking about.
I'm talking about scientific evidence.
I don't give a flying flip how scientific it is. Go back to the damn drawing board. I didn't do it. John Ramsey didn't do it, and we didn't have a clue of anybody who did do it. So we all got to start working together from here, this day forward, to try to find out who the hell did it.
48 Hours Investigates has acquired these tapes, hours upon hours of footage that take you inside the investigation. While the tapes show how strongly prosecutors believe John and Patsy Ramsey were responsible for the death of their daughter, frankly, there isn't a lot of physical evidence that links them. So questioners looked for inconsistencies and focused on minute details from the crime scene.
What have you heard about pineapple?
Well, we were asked, you know, did JonBenet eat pineapple? And because apparently it was found in her system. I think part of the question was, what did she eat it in when she got home? You know, I'm sure she didn't because she was absolutely sound asleep.
The Ramseys told police that JonBenet had gone straight to bed that night and had not eaten at home. But autopsy results did find undigested pineapple in JonBenet's stomach. And police discovered fingerprints on a bowl of pineapple left in the family's dining room on the morning of the murder.
I didn't put the bowl there, okay? I did not put the bowl there. I would not do this setup like this.
Okay, but let's go back to your line of reasoning here. If they weren't, no. Talk to me.
Okay.
Look at me.
Okay.
If they're not yours and they're not John's, then they would be somebody else's.
Right.
But now I'm telling you they're not somebody else's. Those prints belong to one of the two of you.
They did? You're sure? Well, I don't know. I did not put that there.
The fingerprints on the bowl are Patsy's, according to police, suggesting that she's the one who gave the fruit to her daughter. But if Patsy did give it to JonBenet and is lying about it, then investigators wondered,
Could she be lying about everything?
You know, sometimes the simplest, most obscure little thing could be so significant.
Okay. I did not feed JonBenet pineapple.
Okay.
So I don't know how it got in her stomach. I don't know where this bowl of pineapple came from. I can't recall putting that there.
After 3 days of questioning, the interrogation in 1998 ended. And even though the Ramseys were not indicted, Boulder authorities continued to believe they were guilty. So in August of 2000, prosecutors flew to Atlanta, where the Ramseys were living, asking to see and hear new evidence. 48 Hours has also acquired those tapes.
If ever there were going to be an intruder on trial, the defense is going to be that you did it. Remember that?
I remember that, but I'm not here to prove my innocence. I'm here to find the killer of my daughter.
With John, prosecutors asked questions mostly about leads he had uncovered on other suspects. But with Patsy, interrogators were more accusatory, suggesting they had new evidence, clothing fibers that would tie her directly to the murder.
You were shown photographed wearing a red coat.
It's kind of a black and red and gray fleece.
Bruce Levin from the Boulder District Attorney's Office led the questioning.
This is Ramsey. I have scientific evidence from forensic scientists that say that there's fibers in the paint tray that match your red jacket.
The paint tray is significant because a brush from it, along with some rope, was used to strangle and sexually abuse JonBenet.
We believe that fibers from her jacket were found in the paint tray, were found tied into the ligature found on JonBenet's neck, were found on the blanket that she's wrapped in, were found on the duct tape that's found on her mouth. I have no evidence from any scientist to suggest that those fibers are from any source other than your red jacket.
Well, but yeah, that's, come on, I mean, what other sources did they test?
Patsy's attorney, Lynn Wood, asked prosecutors to produce the evidence. When they wouldn't, he refused to let Patsy go on the record. But she did go on the record with us.
What do you think about these fibers?
After John discovered the body and she was brought to the living room, when I laid eyes on her, I knelt down and hugged her. But I had my whole body on her body. My sweater fibers or whatever I had on that morning are going to transfer to her clothing.
In all the questioning, the prosecutors focused more on Patsy than John, following their belief that she was the killer.
JonBenet got up, and somebody in that house, legally, lawfully in that house, one of the three of you, also happens to be up, or gets up because she makes noise. And there's some discussion, or something happens, there's an accident, somebody...
You're going down the wrong path, buddy.
Okay. Somebody accidentally, or somebody gets upset over bedwetting, that's one of the things that's been proposed. Okay.
Didn't happen. Okay. If she got up in the night and ran into somebody, it was somebody there that wasn't supposed to be there. I don't know what transpired after that, whether it was an accident, intentional, premeditated, or whatnot. But it was not one of her three family members that were also in that house. Period. End of statement.
These tapes don't always show the Ramseys at their best. But remarkably, it was the Ramseys who made them available, saying they want all the information on this case out in the open. As for the Boulder police and prosecutors, they denied repeated requests from 48 Hours to discuss these tapes or any of the issues we're raising tonight. Their only comment on the Ramsey murder investigation is no comment.
I mean, I appreciate being here. I appreciate it. It's very hard to be here, but it is a damn sight harder to be sitting at home in Atlanta, Georgia, wondering every second of every day what you guys are doing out here. You know, have you found anything? Are we any closer? Is the guy out here watching my house? You know, is my son safe? My life has been hell from that day forward. And I want nothing more than to find out who is responsible for this.
You just saw this man interrogate the Ramseys.
As a detective, I'm looking for clues.
Wait until you hear what he has to say about the case now.
They may not like what I say, but I'm going to say it.
So far tonight, you've had a chance to see and hear John and Patsy Ramsey's denials. You've seen for the first time how they handle themselves under police interrogation. But what story does the physical evidence tell in the murder of their daughter, JonBenet? According to some detectives, it's a far different story than the public has been led to believe. Once again, here's Aaron Moriarty.
This murder was not conducted upstairs in a nice little bedroom. This murder was conducted in the basement, and it was very vicious. And during the murder, somebody sexually assaulted JonBenet. This was all done in the deepest, farthest recesses of that house.
...100 miles away from where JonBenet Ramsey was murdered, in a modest home in Colorado Springs.
How often do you think about this case now?
Probably every day.
67-year-old Lou Smith works every day, alone, trying to find her killer.
I keep a picture of her in my wallet.
You have JonBenet in your wallet?
I keep it all the time.
This is the same Lou Smith you saw interrogating John Ramsey back in 1998.
And I concentrate my investigation on you.
A veteran detective.
This was like the homicides that I worked on.
With such an impressive record for solving homicides that the Boulder district attorney hired him on the Ramsey murder case.
I have to stick up for the Boulder Police Department a little bit.
And when you started, who did you believe killed JonBenet Ramsey?
My gut feeling was the parents did it.
But as Smith followed the evidence and questioned the Ramseys, the more he became convinced that the Boulder police were focusing on the wrong suspects.
John Ramsey came through very, very sincere.
So when I first found her, I was like, thank God I found her.
When I left that interview, there was no doubt in my mind that he had nothing to do with the death of his daughter.
Smith quit the investigation in disgust.
They hired me as a detective to take a look at this case. They may not like what I say, but I'm going to say it. I don't think the Ramseys did it, and I think they ought to start looking for people that did.
Smith says the answer is in the evidence. The autopsy report. The intricate garrote used as a murder weapon. The strange marks on JonBenet's back. And most importantly, the information found in this DNA report.
As a detective, I'm looking for clues.
What is it that convinces Lou Smith that someone other than the Ramseys killed their six-year-old daughter? First and foremost, the brutality of the crime. Nearly every medical expert who has seen the autopsy report agrees on one thing. This was not an accidental death. JonBenet Ramsey was cruelly and deliberately murdered. We need to warn you that what you are about to see is very disturbing.
What do we see here?
JonBenet was strangled not once, says Smith, but twice with this intricately made device known as a garrote that had to have been made by the killer during the murder.
You see hair right inside the windings of that cord. That's JonBenet's hair.
It's a device, says Smith, that was not left there for show. Whoever killed JonBenet used the garrote to strangle her.
But that shows a very brutal death. Notice how bright red that is. I'm being very clinical here. That is bright red. What that means is that she was alive when that was pressed into her neck that hard.
JonBenet was not only alive, Smith believes she was fighting for her life. There were marks that look a lot like scratches on her neck.
She did have her own DNA under her fingernails. I'm pretty sure that's a scratch to get that off. I think she was struggling then.
At some point, the child was then hit over the head with such force, it crushed her skull. But her nightmare wasn't over. Shortly before she died, investigators believe she was sexually assaulted with a piece of the paintbrush that was used to make the garrote.
There's no motive for the parent to do that.
The evidence, says Smith, simply does not support the popular theory that the Ramseys struck their daughter and then tried to cover it up.
It's not a mother waking up in the middle of the night saying, "Oops, I think I hurt my child. Oops, I gotta bring her downstairs and fashion one of these things Then I'm going to put it around her neck, and I'm going to tighten it a couple times while she's struggling. Now, if you want to believe that, go ahead. I can't say this on air, but that's bullshit.
But what about those fibers from Patsy Ramsey's jacket that police say were in the paint tray and on the sticky side of duct tape covering JonBenet's mouth?
Is the fact that there were fibers that were consistent with Patsy Ramsey's jacket incriminating?
Sure.
But does that shake your faith that the Ramseys were not involved?
No. You just can't rely on fiber evidence, because fibers could come off of the jacket or something similar to the jacket.
What's more, says Smith, there were also dozens of unidentified fibers that didn't come from the Ramseys. And Smith is unaware of a single case where a parent used a garrote like this to kill a child.
This is one of the best clues left behind by the killer. This shows what's going on in his mind. This is a sexual device. I'm looking for a pedophile that's a sexual sadist. That's what Lou Smith's looking for.
Smith's not the only one.
Well, there's 57 pages of names that have come out of the tip files. And
Colorado private detective Ollie Gray and his partner John San Agustin were hired by the Ramseys 2 years ago.
That would be JonBenet's room right here on the second level.
Even when the Ramseys ran out of money, Ollie and John stayed on the job.
We probably do something on it two or three times a week.
Even though you're not getting paid?
Sure.
They became convinced of the Ramseys' innocence after seeing this lab report.
I acquired a document that you see right here that names John and Patsy Ramsey as suspects. It was submitted for analysis reference DNA.
Just days after JonBenet was murdered, her parents were asked to give DNA samples to the Boulder police.
The two of you have given DNA evidence to the police?
Absolutely.
Blood, hair, DNA, everything. We've given them everything they've asked for.
Their DNA was compared to foreign DNA found under their daughter's fingernails and in her panties, which may have been left by the killer.
Does any of that DNA match anyone in the Ramsey family?
No. This analysis eliminates the Ramseys.
If our DNA matched anything significant, they would have arrested us in a New York minute. And don't ever think they wouldn't have.
If not the Ramseys, then who killed JonBenet?
This is why I believe that the killer got in.
Retired homicide detective Lou Smith was still working on the official investigation when he concluded that a stranger came into the Ramsey home.
He opened the grate, he went in,
and killed their six-year-old daughter.
There's three windows there. The center one was the one that was open. Take a look real closely at the window on the left. What you're going to see is leaves and debris pressed right up against the window. Now let's take a look at the one again in the center. No leaves or debris.
Which says?
That window was open. Directly below that open window, you have a suitcase. Directly around that suitcase, you have leaves and debris from that window well around that suitcase. Also see, if you look very closely, you're going to see a mark that goes right down the wall.
Right here.
A scuff mark that Smith believes was left by someone either climbing in or climbing out.
You can fit through that window?
Oh, without any problem.
In fact, he has, as you can see in this video, shot as part of Smith's investigation.
It is much easier to go out that window if you stand on something. You put the suitcase in front, you step on the suitcase, and you're right out into the window well. Lift the grate, you're gone. It's that easy.
But why would an intruder who intended to kill JonBenet leave the bizarre 2.5-page ransom note written with paper and a pen belonging to Patsy? Boulder police have always believed that Patsy used it to make the killing look like a kidnapping.
But if someone had been targeting JonBenet Ramsey, wouldn't he at least bring the paper and the pencil to write this ransom note? I mean,
they probably wouldn't bring it in. Why would you bring in something that can be traced back to your house, where you have the pen and the ink, and you have the paper right there that it was written on?
But you can't count on finding that in the house.
Can't count on it. Most houses have that.
No expert could eliminate Patsy Ramsey as the writer of the ransom note. That's damning, isn't it?
No, not at all. You always are going to have similarities in handwriting. To sit down and write a note like that, with all of those details in there, after you brutally killed your daughter, you'd never done that before. Come on, give me a break.
But more than any other evidence, Schmidt believes these small marks left on JonBenet's face and back prove an intruder killed her.
The killer had a stun gun. I am sure the killer had a stun gun.
A stun gun, an electrical weapon used to incapacitate the little girl in order to move her to the basement. Schmidt believes only an intruder would need to use one.
There's no reason at all for the parents to have used a stun gun to help stage the murder of their daughter.
Was there any indication that the Ramseys had ever owned a stun gun?
There is nothing to indicate the Ramseys ever owned a stun gun.
What's significant about these injuries, says Schmidt, is that those on the child's face and those on her back appear to be an equal distance apart.
It's approximately 3.5 centimeters.
Much like the prongs of this stun gun.
And they're approximately 3.5 centimeters apart.
And if I push this,
Dr. Michael Doberson,
you can see the electricity arcing.
The coroner for neighboring Arapahoe County also believes the marks on JonBenet were left by a stun gun.
What we have to do is match up the injuries with the weapon.
And to prove it, he used one on the skin of an anesthetized pig.
What am I seeing on the left?
What you're seeing on the left is you're seeing the actual injuries on the back of JonBenet. The marks are similar in size and shape and color, and are a certain distance apart. On the pig, too, you see marks that were left on the skin of the pig.
While there are some differences, both Doberson and Schmidt believe the experiment confirms a stun gun was used.
If it's not a stun gun, I'd like to know what it is.
Three other pathologists agreed, but the Boulder police are relying instead on this man's opinion.
How sure are you that it's not a stun gun?
Well, I'm 100% sure, because stun gun injuries don't look that way.
Dr. Werner Spitz, a nationally known forensic pathologist who has worked on major cases, including the assassination of John F. Kennedy.
This is now on her. This was done on a pig skin.
And you're telling me that this looks to you like the other one? The ones that JonBenet has? They don't look like that to me at all. A stun gun injury is an electrical burn. It's a burn, essentially. And these don't look like burns.
Instead, Spitz believes the large dark mark on JonBenet's face was left by a snap on a piece of clothing.
You know, like the snaps they have on blue jeans, for instance. Mm-hmm. If you look at this one, mm-hmm. below the ear, this thing here, if you look at this closely with a magnifying glass, you will see that within this brownish mark, there is a boat-shaped structure, which is missing in any of the other injuries.
Unfortunately, with only photographs to go by, no expert, not Dr. Spitz nor Dr. Doberson, can be 100% sure.
Wouldn't that have been the best way to know, or come the closest to knowing, is if you could have exhumed the body and line up a stun gun and see if it matches those injuries?
Sure. I believe that that would have probably been the most accurate way to do it.
Lou Schmidt admits that in the months following JonBenet's death, investigators considered going to court to have her body exhumed, but decided against it.
We had buried our child. She was at peace. That was just an abhorrent thought.
But John, that might have been the one way to know for sure. That could have resolved the whole issue, because if a stun gun was used, it was not the parents.
Certainly, and we've got people that have told us that know what they're doing, that with 95% medical certainty that a stun gun was used. No question.
But you would have known with 100% certainty if you had exhumed the body, as tough as that would have been.
This is my child you're talking about. It's not a body. It's different.
Still, Smith believes a stun gun is the key to JonBenet's murder.
I see the killer at the end of the intruder path.
And he's searching for a killer or killers who own one.
The person who did this, if we're right, he's still out there.
We'll show you evidence the police ignored for years, and should they have taken a closer look at this man.
The investigators we've spoken to say there are literally dozens of people the police in Boulder, Colorado should have taken a closer look at. But they haven't, say the critics, because police remain focused on JonBenet's parents as the prime suspects in her murder. Aaron Moriarty has been following up on several leads pursued by the Ramsey's investigators. And she focuses in now on one man with a frightening past.
On the cold December night that marked the one-year anniversary of JonBenet's murder, dozens of mourners showed up for a candlelight vigil outside the Ramsey home. One man, in particular, caught investigator Lou Smith's eye.
Many times, criminals do return to the scene, and that was on the anniversary. That puts him right there at the Ramsey house a year later.
He's Gary Oliva, a 38-year-old convicted sex offender from Oregon who lives in Boulder.
He definitely is a sex offender for assaulting another 7-year-old girl in Oregon. He spent time in prison for that.
Smith is convinced that a pedophile came into the Ramsey home and killed their daughter.
On my computer, I probably got 25 good leads, and I probably have another 50 pages of other leads to follow.
Among the files he's keeping on sex offenders in Boulder, Gary Oliva's name stands out. In 1991, the year after he sexually assaulted the little girl, police reports say he tried to strangle his mother with a telephone cord. And in December 1996, Oliva may have been only a few houses away from JonBenet's bedroom window.
This is the alley behind the
Ramsey's. This is the alley that runs behind the Ramsey's home. Leads into the backyard, to the garage area.
It wasn't uncommon for JonBenet and Burke to ride their bicycles around the alleyway.
John San Agustin and Ollie Gray, the Ramsey's private investigators, say Oliva frequented these buildings owned by a local church.
You know, a lot of transient people come here for food and also to pick up their mail.
But why is this relevant?
The Ramsey home is what, 10 houses?
Right up this
alley. Right up this alley.
Why do they believe he was in the neighborhood the night JonBenet was murdered?
He called me on the phone.
Because of this man and a phone call he got from Gary Oliva.
He related to me that he'd done something horrible.
He asked us to identify him only as Michael, Gary Oliva's best friend from high school.
He mentioned he was in Boulder in the phone call.
The call, Michael says, came just days after the Ramsey murder. Gary told him he had hurt a child.
He just was sobbing like you've never heard a grown man sob or cry before in your life. And I knew it was serious.
So serious that Michael, living in a nearby state, called the Boulder police.
What made you connect that phone call and your friend with the murder in Colorado?
The things that he told me in the phone call, the cassette tapes.
These cassette tapes.
Look how many tapes. I've got 4 times as many tapes as...
After high school, Michael and Gary thought a fun way to keep in touch was through audio tapes.
I go to Carl's Jr. and interview somebody. He'd go to a store and interview a macaroon cookie. Stupid stuff.
But in 1989, Gary's tapes, once amusing, changed dramatically.
The tapes got darker. A song with lyrics I can't repeat are more depraved and sicker. On this tape, it sounds like he's killing an animal. It would turn my stomach. On this tape, he talks about necrophilia. This ain't about a macaroon cookie anymore. This isn't funny anymore. On this tape, you have him.
What you're about to hear on this tape, according to Michael, is Oliva at his worst, pretending he's been left alone to babysit a friend's daughter.
Oh, you can't play this on camera.
Why?
Oh, he's talking about raping a little girl on camera. Oh, this one makes me sick.
How are you doing, Runette?
Hi.
That's nice. Now, why don't you come over here and sit on my lap and let me touch your back? How do you like that?
On another tape, he talks about hurting a child.
Some of the things that I do, like making bacon strips out of little girls. I'm into it, you know. Being a sick dog.
And this wasn't a joke.
These tapes are not a joke at all. When you listen to these cassette tapes, you've got to do something if you're a human being. I mean, you have to.
Michael says he left all his information on the Boulder Police tip line.
I told him about the cassette tapes. I told him about the phone call. I mentioned I had handwriting samples.
What did the Boulder Police do with this tip? Nothing. According to Lou Smith, the police didn't follow up on 95% of the more than 3,000 phone tips that came in. In Oliva's case, they didn't investigate him until nearly 4 years after JonBenet Ramsey's death.
when he was caught with drugs. And guess what else? A stun gun.
Did you ever use that stun gun on a child?
No.
Oliva, who was wanted in Oregon for parole violations, turned himself into the Boulder police 2 weeks ago.
Did you hurt or kill JonBenet Ramsey?
No. No, I didn't.
Didn't you tell your friend that you were attracted to little girls?
I don't think I want to answer that.
Okay. You were living in Boulder at the time JonBenet was killed?
Yeah.
Just down the street?
Yeah.
While Oliva says he doesn't remember making the disturbing audio tapes, what he will admit to is an obsession with JonBenet.
I believe that she came to me after she was killed and revealed herself to me.
As it turns out, we're not the only ones interested in Oliva. A Boulder police officer showed up to take notes.
I would be concerned if any lead was not fully taken to ground.
Former Boulder District Attorney Alex Hunter says police tried to follow up on pedophiles, but admits that early on, the force was clearly overwhelmed.
Didn't your office have to tell police officers, you gotta look at these other leads? You can't just focus on the Ramses.
Well, it was said, probably not in quite that language, but yes.
Can I have a cigarette?
Why didn't authorities take a sex offender like Oliva more seriously? Just this week, Boulder police said Oliva is not a suspect. Sources say his DNA doesn't match evidence at the scene.
Nor does ours.
What do you think of that?
I think it's a double standard, don't you?
Is it fair to say then that the state of the evidence right now, there just isn't enough to convict the Ramseys beyond a reasonable doubt?
There isn't enough to convict anybody beyond a reasonable doubt.
But Alex Hunter believes this case someday can be solved, although he doesn't think Lou Smith is the man to do it.
Do you feel that Lou Smith's feelings for the Ramseys clouded his judgment?
I think a little bit.
Hunter believes Smith, a devout Christian, crossed a line when working as a DA investigator, he prayed with the Ramseys.
Do you think maybe you've gotten too close to Ramseys?
Well, let's put it this way, I don't think I did. If the Ramseys did this and I found out, I'd be first one standing in line at the Boulder Police Department.
JonBenet Ramsey would have been 12 years old this year and in sixth grade. Instead, she's buried in a Georgia cemetery while her brutal killer or killers go free.
From the moment of JonBenet Ramsey's murder, police admit mistakes were made at the crime scene that make the case harder to solve. That's been a source of frustration for investigators who suspect her parents, John and Patsy Ramsey, and for others who believe it had to be someone else. Yet even with all the frustration, and despite the passage of time, almost 6 years, nearly everyone working the case agrees on one thing. They say there is still enough good physical evidence to make this a solvable crime, and there is still good reason to believe that there will eventually be justice for JonBenet Ramsey. Now, take a look at a preview of our next broadcast of 48 Hours Investigates.